We are honored and blessed that you have joined us this morning to worship the Lord in spirit, in truth. Our call to worship is taken from Psalms 24 and verse 7 through 9. The Bible says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." Who is the King of glory? The Lord is strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your gates, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Just for the other Father, thank you for all your blessings to us this week. Father, we prepare our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. Come join us and do something special for us today. Tabernacle, dwell with us. Bless each person that's watching us today by live stream. Give them a blessing that they cannot room enough to receive it. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's just a challenge. It's a challenge to get up every day and have
today we want to focus on the blessing, the covenant blessing, the Lord's guidance. The Bible says in Psalm 139, verses 10 and 11, even there shall I lead thee, and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely darkness will cover me, even the night shall be light about me. That's Psalm 139, verses 10 and 11. The Bible says, in all my ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct my paths. Proverbs, verse 3 and verse 6. The Bible says, and thy ear shall hear a word that I may say, this is the way. Walk ye in. When you turn your right hand and to the left, and you will hear a word that I may say, this is the way. Walk ye in. When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left. The promise of God for us today is that God has promised to give us His guidance. That's right. Father, we thank you for Jesus who died in our place, that we might have life eternal. We thank you for the promise of your word, that you will lead us and that you will guide us. And God, in times of difficulty, times of perplexity, and times of confusion, wondering which way to go, to go to the back, and to go to the right. There is nothing in the Lord to say, this is the way. This is the direction. This is the path that I'm happy to go. This is the way. Walk in. When you turn to the right, walk in.
Thank you. Just remember, even though your circumstance may not look like what he promised, that he is still good. And he's brought us through so many different things. Everybody said their own individual story. You come from something. You've been through something. Because it's the challenge that corrects us and perfects us and more who we are and what we do and build our character. So you got to hold on to that faith. Remember that what he brought you through. over your life and how that relationship has developed or had challenges and bumps in the road. Can you ask yourself the question, was there anything else like falling in love with Jesus? Do you remember that? Do you remember when you got that spark of conviction in your heart and said, I want to give this to somebody I want to give my life to? That person who died for me is somebody that I want to love and serve forever. Do you remember that? Does anybody remember going down to the water grave of baptism or walking down the aisle to an appeal or reading a scripture and then that light bulb just went off and said, He loves me. Thank you.
Inheritance was that they stayed at the deceased friend's former estate for 5 days. If these friends could put up with each other for those 5 days, the inheritance would be theirs. If they could not, if any of those individuals, if any of those friends decided that they were going to leave, then they got nothing. But little did they know that during their stay, during their 5 days, tempers would flare. Old grudges would be rehashed. Dark secrets would come to the light. And all of this would threaten their chance of receiving their inheritance. Now, as I read the plot of this story, it sounded eerily familiar to the story that we find in our text for this morning. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask that you would turn with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. And the Bible says, "Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers." This afternoon, I'm going to talk just for a moment on the topic, dysfunctional people. Dysfunctional people. In our text for today, we find the story of another group of dysfunctional people. A group of people who would also come together after the death of a mutual friend. These dysfunctional people, they too would reunite in an upper room to work through some issues, to put some things on the table, to fix some character flaws, to get rid of some grudges. And they would do this all in an attempt to receive the inheritance their deceased friend promised before he died. And beloved, those who are watching, I want us to not miss the fact that this group that reunited in this upper room, this group had also had to work through some issues. They also needed to get rid of some grudges. They also had to put away some character flaws, because like the first group, this was also a group of dysfunctional people. Like what you would find in the church, in this upper room, you had people with different backgrounds and from different walks of life, folks who grew up in different neighborhoods with different upbringings, and they were all bringing their own experiences and their own, in many cases, their own baggage to the group, to this upper room. Yet the Bible tells us that somehow these individuals with these different personalities, or maybe all of these dysfunctional people, would need to find a way to put everything else aside, to put everything aside, all of their differences and all of their character flaws and all of their dysfunction, and come together on one accord in order to receive the inheritance that was waiting for them. And so this group that met in the upper room, you had individuals like Peter, who you could say was really a classic example of what it means to be dysfunctional. And even though Peter would later go into full-time ministry after going to the Oakwoods and the Andrews and the PCs, and even though he would eventually become a leader in the New Testament church, when you look back at the life of Peter, you realize that this was an individual, this was a brother that had some issues. One of the problems with Peter was that he had a hard time controlling his tongue. And so Peter was one of those individuals that was always quick to talk and slow to listen. And so he'd get himself into trouble a lot because he just didn't know how to shut up. For some reason, Peter always had to have something to say. If you remember in Mark chapter 9 and verse 5, when he, James, and John are on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus, instead of just being quiet and enjoying the moment, the Bible says that Peter asked if he should build a tent for him, for Jesus, Moses, and Elijah. And the Bible says that the only reason Peter asked was because he didn't know what else to say. Have mercy. So he couldn't just sit there and enjoy the moment. He couldn't just sit there and say nothing. Peter had to find something to say. But then on top of that, Peter was also an impulsive person because Peter would often react without thinking. If you remember in Mark chapter 14, it was Peter who cut the soldier's ear off when they came to arrest Jesus. And so when they come, Peter doesn't ask any questions. He wasn't trying to find out if they had made a mistake. Peter just pulls out his switchblade and starts cutting the man's ear off. Now I know the Bible says the sword, but in my sanctified imagination, in my preacher's imagination, you know, we got to embellish stuff sometimes. So I can imagine he just pulls out his switchblade, y'all, and he begins to just cut off the soldier's ear. So Peter was also impulsive. He could not control his tongue. Peter could not be trusted. In Mark chapter 14, when Peter and the disciples of Jesus are in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus asked Peter and the other disciples to just do two simple things. Stay here, watch and pray. Jesus goes away to pray and to talk to the Father. When he comes back, these brothers are knocked out. Sleep. And so Jesus asked them again to just watch and pray. And so Jesus, of course, he goes away again, but when he comes back, they are asleep again. Peter could not be trusted. He could not be trusted. Jesus could not trust Peter to do two separate things, watch and pray. When you get to Galatians chapter 2, you find out that Peter was also prejudiced.
Yeah.
He was self-conscious.
Yeah.
Because Peter would not eat with the Gentiles for fear of what the other Jews, the other Adventists, might think. So Peter was impulsive. He couldn't control his tongue. He was not reliable. He was a prejudice. He was self-conscious. That Peter was bipolar. Because he just didn't know what to expect from Peter from one moment to the next. For example, one moment Peter has enough faith to walk on water. And at the next moment he's drowning, asking for the Lord to save him. One moment he's telling Jesus, Lord, I got your back. I'm with you. I'm wrong or die.
Yeah, yeah.
And the next moment, he's telling her, I don't even know that brother. I haven't seen him before in my life. I don't know what you're talking about.
Don't know.
One moment, he's taking the gospel to the Gentiles. The next moment, he won't even sit down and eat them. And so, brother, Peter had issues. In fact, I would dare say, Peter was so messed up that in Mark chapter 8 and verses 31 through 33, Peter even rebukes the Lord.
Yeah.
He rebukes
much.
But then you had James and John. And they were raised in what we would call the typical family. And the reason I say the typical family is because even though their father was a wealthy fisherman and probably made pretty good money, he was not a Christian. The Bible only mentions their mother being a Christian. And because their father was a fisherman, he was probably gone for long periods of time, which meant the responsibility of raising these two young boys was left up to their mother. And if you're like me, then you understand, you know that a woman cannot teach a boy how to be a man. And because of that, I can imagine these two young men, these two brothers, straying away in time or two. And so much so that by the time you read the scriptures, Jesus is nicknaming James and John the sons of thunder. Which tells you what kind of men these two had become. Now the text doesn't mention it, but if I sanctify imagination, I can imagine they were probably from tatted, they were probably tatted up from head to toe. Maybe even did some time behind bar, probably kept questionable company. They were probably violent and had a short temperament. They were probably quick to go off on folks from time to time. As a matter of fact, in Luke chapter 9 and verse 51, when the folks don't want to accept the gospel, when the Bible words come to the door, and they knock on the door, and the people don't want to accept Bible study, the Bible says that they ask Jesus if they can call down fire on them. Have mercy. Have mercy.
That was sick.
That's like, you know, when I was, before I came to church, the Bible word, and so, you go Bible, you go on the door, you knock on the door, you try to solicit, trying to get people to say Bible study, and just imagine, you go into a door, and the person says no. And so after I leave, I go and I come into a corner and I pray and I ask the Lord to rain down fire on this house because they do not want to accept the Bible study that I want to give. But one of these, I need to tell you, these are the folks that are in church. Folks like Peter who just say what they think you want to hear. Folks like James and John who just got an attitude for no reason. Folks who that if you cut these yokes off in traffic might just go off on you. We're talking about dysfunctional people. And then you had Matthew, the tax collector. Now you know this brother was shady because he worked for the IRSR. The Internal Revenue Service of Rome. So this brother's job was literally to find ways to overtax the people and cheat you out of your money. So what he would do is he would steal from you during the week. Then he would smile in your face and say happy Sabbath when he saw you at church. Have mercy. Then there was Simon the Zealot. The Zealots were this radical, militant, religious, political party that was basically the New Testament version of the Tea Party. They were anti-government, and they hated everything about Rome. They hated the fact that Rome was in power. They hated the fact that Rome taxed the people. And so you can imagine that in this upper room, it had to be an awkward conversation situation where you have Matthew, a tax collector for the Roman government, in the same room with Simon the Zealot, who hated everything about Rome. But according to the text, that's what you had. You had these two individuals in the same room. That's like having a Trump supporter, that person, and a Biden supporter, strong Trump supporter, and strong Biden supporter in the same room, trying to figure out a way to work things out. And so you had Peter, you had James, John, Matthew, Simon, the Zealot, you had Thomas,
who they call Dolly Thomas. And they call him this because he was skeptical about everything. This is the same brother that said, unless you show me, I don't believe in nothing. I got to see it to believe it. And the crazy thing is, we got those kind of folks in the church today. Folks who will doubt everything. Folks who refuse to believe anything Jesus is. Folks who believe everything else and everybody else, but they refuse to believe what the word says. Like Thomas, their answer is, unless I see, I won't believe it. Unless I can see it with my own eyes. Unless I can touch it, then I won't believe it. And so you got Peter, James, John, Matthew, Simon, and Thomas. You have all of these dysfunctional brothers. And you would think that that's it. You would think that it can't be any worse. Then you find out there's more, because there are also women in the church who were just as dysfunctional as the men. Because you had Mary Magdalene, who had met them. Now listen, Mary Magdalene had to be psychologically damaged. Because everybody in Antioch knew her past. Yeah. Everybody in the city. Just imagine everybody in the city that you live in knowing all your business. And so everybody knows that you're an alcoholic, or everybody knows that you're a drug addict, or they know that you used to sleep around all the time. Imagine everybody knows that you're a thief or a liar or whatever it may be, whatever your sin is. Imagine what it must have felt like knowing that everybody in the city knew your sin, and that's what people thought about every time your name was mentioned. Imagine how psychologically damaging that is. Imagine the trauma that must have caused her. Not to mention the fact that at one point she had also been possessed by demons. So you know when Mary Magdalene came into the room, when she came into the upper room, she came with issues, with problems, with stuff, with baggage. Then there was Joanna, who was also a follower of Jesus. And she was a follower of Jesus despite the fact that her husband was a steward or a manager for King Herod. The same King Herod that will later persecute the church in the book of Acts. Imagine what that home must have been like. Your husband working for the same government that would eventually want to see you killed. And so you know Joanna, just like Mary Magdalene, Joanna also came to the upper room, came to the church with baggage. Then there was Salome, James and John's mother. And Salome was interesting because this was a woman that you really had to be on the lookout for, because she was the type that would smile in your face on Monday morning, but stab you in the back on Monday afternoon. This is the same one that said, "Hi, good to see you," when she came into work, but later on in the afternoon, she's in the boss's office telling all your business. Same one. Because remember, she was the one, Salome was the one, who pulled Jesus aside. Hey, and said, look, don't tell nobody. But you know, I mean, you know, when you come into your kingdom,
hook up my boys.
Can my boys sit on the right and left?
Yeah, no.
And so Salome was one of these individuals that was devious and conniving, and you really didn't know what she was up to. Then you had Jesus' mother. Mercy. Now, you know Jesus, you know Mary had to be messed up. Because Mary had literally just seen, we're in Acts chapter 1 now, Mary had just seen her son Imagine the trauma. And so, you know, anybody who goes through something like that, has to be dealing with some issues. Has to be going, but these are the folk in mercy. So you got Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Salome, Christ's mother. It also says Jesus' brothers were there too. And the thing is, they were his family, but they were just as bad. They were probably even worse. Because, listen, you had Doubting Thomas, but at least Thomas wasn't part of the family. At least he wasn't related to Jesus, but these jokers, the brothers of Jesus, didn't even believe their own brother. They probably thought he was just making stuff up, trying to get attention. So his own family didn't even believe he was the Christ. And you know it's bad when your own folk don't trust in you. When your own people don't believe in you. And so you have all dysfunctional people, Peter and James and John and Matthew and Simon and Zebedee. You got Thomas and Mary Magdalene and Salome and Joanna and Mary, the mother of Jesus. You got his brothers. You got all of these dysfunctional people. And these are not people, hear me. These are not the folks outside the church.
Check up. Check up.
These are not the folk outside the church. These are the folk in the church.
Mercy.
Folk in the
church. All these dysfunctional, broken dogs. These are the folks. These are the folks that God, that Jesus has entrusted to share the gospel.
Mercy.
These are the individuals that he has given the task of sharing this good news. Folks that are messed up, folks that are broken, folks that lie, folks that cheat, folks that got anger issues, folks that steal, folks that can't control their tongue, folks that have checkered past, folks that got dysfunctional homes, folks that used to do drugs, folks that used to sleep around, folks that used to be alcoholics, folks that are mean, folks that just going through some stuff, folks that have seen some stuff, folks that have at one time or another lost their mind.
Come on.
But these are the people. These are the people that God is depending on. Folks like you and me, Lord.
There it is.
Mercy.
There it is.
It's one two things have to be true. Either God is very smart, or he's very stupid. Because how can he trust somebody like me? Somebody is broken like, how can he trust us to do such a task? Mercy.
Mercy.
How? He's dependent on folks like you and me. These are individuals that had flaws, individuals that were sinners, individuals that fell short every day. I mean, this is crazy. Even at the time when Jesus is going to get crucified, Peter is denying him. But he still trusted Jesus, and he still trusted Peter enough to allow to a dying world. Mercy.
ordinary men and women, but end up doing extraordinary things for God because they recognize their shortcomings. They recognize that they were messed up. They recognize they were broken. They recognize that all of their righteousness was as filthy rag. They recognize that there was nothing good in them. And here's the thing. Not only did they recognize that about themselves, but they recognize that about their brothers and sisters. See, sometimes we get so holy. See, we think our stuff don't stay no more. So what happens is, I have attained. Okay? Now, I don't know why you're still struggling. But see, I have attained it. And so what happens is, we get so heavily by it. We think we're so ready for translation. And we forget, saints, that we're just as broken as everybody else. Come on. But what happens is we have to be willing to understand that my brother and my sister are just as broken as I am. They may not be broken in the same places. But we're all broken.
Yeah.
But the wonderful blessing about the story is that God is able to use broken pieces, broken people, to do a wonderful, mighty work for Him. As long as those individuals realize that they are broken and everybody that they are working with are broken.
Come on now.
See, the thing is, when you continue in the story, in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit comes down. Mercy. Hold on. See, we've been told that we all gotta be perfect before the Spirit comes. Lord have mercy. Come on now. See, the text that, now look, in Acts chapter 2, right after they choose Matthias, the Holy Spirit comes down. So all of a sudden, listen. Peter and all of a sudden become perfect. All of Mary's issues, all of Joanna's issues, all of Matthew's and Simon's issues didn't all of a sudden go away.
Come on, man.
They didn't become perfect. Now, are we to strive for perfection? Are we to strive to live the way God wants to live? Yes. Don't miss that. But if we are able to see one another the way God sees us and come together on one accord, the Holy Spirit can come down on this church and we can do a mighty work in this community.
Come on, preach now.
We got to be willing, saints. We got to be willing to recognize our brokenness.
Come on.
You see, these ordinary men and women would do extraordinary things for God because they recognized their shortcomings. But they did not allow their shortcomings to hinder them from initiating a movement that would spread across the face of the earth. Beloved, each and every one of us is a part of that movement. And I'm just crazy enough to believe that we can do the same thing that they did. We can change the world. We can change the world. We have to be willing to come together on one accord, not focusing on our differences, not focusing on our brokenness, not focusing on anything that keeps us apart, but looking at what makes us all alike, what makes us all one. And that is our mutual love for Jesus Christ. My appeal this afternoon is simple. See your brother and your sister the way God sees you. See your brother and your sister the way that you see yourself. do miraculous things in our church, in the people in our church. But he needs for us to recognize who we are. Not be quick to discount others, not be quick to throw stones, but be able to come together on one accord to be the mission of Jesus Christ. Somebody watching today, you may be watching for the first time, you may not be watching for the first time. You need to make a decision of Jesus today. You may need to get Bible studies, you may need baptism, you may need a rebaptism, you may need prayer, special prayer, whatever your need is. You can ask people to reach out to us. Prayer at SouthNashvilleSDA.org. We want to help you along in this journey. You can't do this by yourself. You can't. Oftentimes we try, but we can't. And so I ask you to reach out to us at prayer at SouthNashvilleSDA.org and allow us to walk you through this journey. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much that you use broken people like us to do a great work. Lord, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus that you would be with every man, woman, boy, or girl that is viewing, that is watching this service online. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to their hearts in such a way that they might be drawn closer and closer to the Lord, so that when you come, each one of us might be prepared and ready to be full of peace. We thank you. So all we got. In Jesus' name we pray.
This morning, as you prepare to worship the Lord and give him, the Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verses 16 through 12, the Bible says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there might be food in my house. And try me now, this said the Lord of hosts, I will now open unto you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing that there should not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sake, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, neither shall your barn fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all nations will call you blessed, for ye shall be a device of man, says the Lord of hosts. I want to ask for just a few moments that you might consider three ways that blesses us. Three ways that God blesses us. The first way that God blesses us is that he promises that the 9 tenths, after we return to being with God and an offering of love and gratitude, he promises that the 9 tenths will go far with this blessing than the total income will go with God. If you die, you don't believe it, that's true. Just ask anybody. That's a thankful God. It's the second way. God's blessings are not always financial. God's blessings are not always financial. They may include health, peace of mind, answered prayer, protection, a close knit and loving family, additional physical strength, ability to make wise decisions, a spirit of thankfulness, a closer relationship with Jesus, a success in soul winning, maybe even an old car that keeps running longer than it should. I know that's right. It's a double way God blesses us. He becomes partner in everything. Let me say that again. He becomes our partner in everything. I don't know about you, but in times like these, we need a partner. We need someone on our side. We need someone to stop our back and our front and our sides. And someone that's still on top of us and over us. We need a partner that sees things that we don't see. We need a partner that knows things that we don't know. We need a partner that can show us what we cannot see. He promised us that our mind tends to go further. He promised us that all the blessings that we receive from our He promised us to be our partner in everything. We take God up on His word. We take God up on His promise. As He's faithful in time and in our lives. Let's pray a blessing as you give today. Father, we thank you for every blessing that you've given to us. Now watch over us for the things. Thank you for every gift and every blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have on the screen there is grace that you connect with us. If you're in the sanctuary this morning, the deacons will be passing off on the plate, but because we cannot be together, we created various avenues for you to return your tithe offering and your gift of love. You can connect with us at SouthNashvilleSDA.org. Pick the button here. We are also prepared to take your gift through PayPal and Cash App. Or you can send your gift in the mail at 244 Tusculum Road here in Nashville, Tennessee. How do you choose to give today? May God's blessing. Well, we are so thankful that you brought us today. We look forward to seeing you next hour as we worship together in spirit and truth. Let's pray our blessing and benediction over you today as we prepare to leave. Father, we are thankful for your goodness and your mercy and for your loving kindness. Now, in Jesus' name, we ask that you watch over and protect the people. Watch over them and speak. Give them the blessing that they stand in need of. Thank you for your goodness and for your mercy. Now the hand is able to keep you from falling. And the risen it falls before a storm of his teenage joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, with dominion and power, both now and before and forevermore. But all the people that love God say. Well, until next time, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. This is